It's my honor to invite
Tariq Fateh Ji.
There has to be a G in India, Tariq Fateh Ji, right? And Captain Raghuraman.
No G.
Thank you both, gentlemen, and thank you all for being such a wonderful audience even before the event has begun. When you call people like Tariq Fateh and call Captain Raghuraman to moderate the discussion with him, introductions are a little silly. Right? You don't call people of non-eminence to come and talk to you, so all of you know who Tariq Ji is. And I don't know how many of you must have read Raghu writing his columns on national strategic affairs in Mint and in various other newspapers. So I will just tell you why we are having this FP Salon event. Debates tend to be intractable anywhere in the world, especially in India. And debates about secularism more so. Debates about intolerance, as we can see, even more so. And religion, let's not even get there. And right now, sir, there's a crop of controversies waiting for you, recent controversies waiting for you in India. Amir Khan, of course, you know, there is this Dadri killing, there is the Tipu Sultan, honoring Tipu Sultan has become a big controversy in India. And I suppose we'll remember a whole lot more. I can't recollect immediately, although don't come to mind. But in all this, in all these years of 60 years, we have come to a place where now this has reached some ridiculous stage where we are only civil to each other. We know what to say. We know what is the good thing to say. We know what the problem is, but we will not put the problem across quite clearly on either side of the secularism debate especially or the intolerance debate. And Tariq Saab is in such a special privileged position as an outsider who can speak and tick off both sides, show both sides the mirror, and talk about what exactly it is that he thinks of India. Why does he call himself a Pakistani born in India? Right? Whole lot of things will emerge out of that. Just one line will actually take you through a journey that might, according to Tariq Ji, will lead to some solutions. So that's where it is, sir. We just want you to have a wonderful conversation. And conversing with him, moderating the discussion is Raghu. Raghu is not, as Tariq Ji just found out, he won't be a mute listener. He will challenge Tariq Ji as strongly as Tariq Ji puts his point across, as he is known to put his point across. So that's exactly what we want. Provoke Tariq Ji. Not that he needs much of provocation. Challenge him and get the best out of him. We will do it. He will converse with him for 1 hour, till about 7:30, 7:35. And then we'll have audience questions, both from the webcast that's happening. We'll take questions on Twitter. There are already some questions that have landed up, and from the audience. Thank you, sirs.
Thank you, Venkat. Thanks a ton. Thank you, Venkat. No, I'm good. I'm good. Are you okay with the mic?
Yes. It works, I think.
Shall we?
Yeah, please. Bismillah kare.
Bismillah. Okay. So, as we say, Sri Ganesh. So, let's begin with... what? Don't we say that? Okay. So let's begin with first introducing you and in your own words. Let's start from the beginning so that we have a context as to what shaped you into who you are, what your views are, and how you view the world from your vantage point.
Well, I was born in 1949 to parents who left Bombay in 1947, November.
Where were they in Bombay? I mean,
they were Kambala Hill. Kambala Hill, yes. Mm-hmm. My grandfather was the French consul in here. He was a French colonel in the First World War. He fought in Flanders. My grandmother was French, and they had a business called the Oxychloride Flooring Company, which still exists. And the grandmother was Congress. The grandfather was Muslim League. His brother was Congress. So the entire family of about, I'm told, 50 people took a steamliner from, I think I'm getting a very strange echo.
Why are we getting an echo? Steamliner, they took a steamliner.
Steamliner, yeah, November 4th, I think they landed in Karachi to start a new life. Karachi was quite similar to Mumbai, except it had a larger Gujarati population, more of a Goan and Zoroastrian color to it. Its main languages were Sindhi and Balochi, but Kachi and Gujarati were the main languages. Anyone who lived in that time would not be able to recognize Karachi today, because all those languages are dead over there. The language that you guys sent to us from Uttar Pradesh today dominates the city. And I was born on a street called Lala Lajpat Rai. Today, nobody in Pakistan would know that name. The neighborhood was called Guru Mandir. And today, that is called Sabil Wali Masjid. The street, the main road was Jamshed Road. Not being a kosher Muslim name, now it is Amil Colony Road. So the city dramatically changed in a matter of...
Move the mic.
It changed quite dramatically in a matter of 10 years. And the Sindhi language was banned. Gujarati education, which continued till when I graduated in 67 from my college, used to be there. Now it's no longer there. So it's a city of a graveyard of cultures. Marwadi is not there. So it is the essence of everything that...
Is that just Karachi or most of the cities in Pakistan?
No, Karachi was a capital, so every one of the Nawabs of UP thought that he had a birthright to kick out anyone from Karachi and lay claim to any house that was left vacant. And this is what happened. So the natives of Karachi were left as foreigners, and the immigrants from UP and CP, the Urdu-speaking elite, laid claim to the city, basically took over the capital and eradicated the native culture. So I was born in that, which is very a strange coincidence. I went to the Choitiram College School in Indore to find out the head of that foundation was my schoolmate. I didn't know, he left 37 years ago. But nothing of that exists anymore. The Sindhi, Kachi, Gujarati culture has evaporated. Jamshed Nasurwanji, who was a mayor for 26 years, a Zoroastrian, you will not find a Zoroastrian alive there unless it's Mr. Kovasji, who is used almost like the Pakistanis. They, we are diverse, we got a Parsi.
We got one.
Yeah, we have one. You know, some of my best friends are Parsis. So I grew up in that climate, went to a Catholic school till 1965. I did know that 1963, I knew where we were heading. I was 13 years old when the mullahs decided you couldn't have Eid on the same day because the moon couldn't be sighted. And that was my first exposure to the contempt for joy a clergy had. Why are kids happy? There must be some Satan around. But the 65 war told me that the big lie, because we were supposed to see angels in the skies taking away Indian bombs in their hands, and holding it up. And
did you believe that when you were 16 years old, it's going to happen?
I went to the roof. I couldn't see it. And I would see old people saying, "Wo dekho, Ali ki talwar." And I couldn't see it. But they would then say that you can only see it if you're a good
pure
Muslim. I guessed I was impure, but you know, when you're in shorts in 15 and you're a Boy Scout and you have some rational thought in you, He said, "Ye Baba pagal hai," you know.
All right, so we were just very quickly recapping Tariq's early childhood and when he moved to Pakistan and how he saw cultures that were rich and that were, please correct me if I'm wrong, which sort of symbolized the multicultural piece slowly turning into one shade and all the other cultures being pushed out, being changed.
Zoological gardens were called Gandhi Gardens and that was eradicated. Many of the buildings that were Mahatma had laid foundation stone because Karachi was a Congress town.
Correct.
Karachi did not elect the Muslim League. It was Bombay that elected Muhammad Ali Jinnah. We didn't.
We sent him to you, but it's okay.
You didn't send him to him. He kicked your ass and went there. Nobody in Bombay has as yet asked this question that you represented us. We elected you for 26 years. What happened?
Anyway, let's get back to your childhood.
Well, after 65, there were two things that happened. We realized that the war with India was because Ayub Khan had lost the election. And Jinnah's sister, Fatma Jinnah, Pakistan at that time had what was called basic democracies. Everyone couldn't vote, but everyone voted 80,000 members of People's Parliament that could vote for the president of the country, which meant 80,000 people could be bought by the military to vote Mr. General Field Marshal Ayub Khan to power. And he couldn't. So in large areas of the frontier and what was then East Pakistan, he barely made it. And the recommendation to him from the mighty Zulfikar Ali Bhutto, who liked Jinnah because of his Hindu ancestry, hated Hindus more than other normal people would, decided that a war with India would be good for Mr. Ayub Khan. And so the Operation Gibraltar was launched on August of 26th, 1965. When Pakistan Army entered Jammu Kashmir in civilian uniforms in violation of international law, committed a war crime. And
That happened in 48 as well?
Yes, but in this time it was far more organized. Mm. In 48, even Netaji's soldiers committed jihad, but that's a different story. Here it was very organized, and to their shock, many of the Pakistani soldiers were given up to the Indian Army by
locals.
And then on August 26th, Pakistan launched an armored attack across the Cham-Jordan border and almost cut off Kashmir from the rest of Jammu Kashmir, rest of India. And if it had not been for a very uncelebrated Prime Minister of India, Mr. Shastri, Kashmir would have never, you would have lost it.
Mm-hmm.
And it was Mr. Shastri who gave the command for the Indian Army to invade, attack Lahore.
On the second front.
Despite the fact, if you're aware that we've just celebrated 50 years of the war, the Defense Secretary, Joint Secretary of Defense, told the Indian Navy to stand down. And the Air Force of the Indian Air Force were left parked on the airfields because jahaz kharab ho jayenge. So the Pakistani Sabre jets knocked out quite a few of your hunters and gnats. But Shastri and those troops, they got into Lahore and then they realized there were no troops there, so they ran back. This happened again in 1971. But we, as young, some of us realized that this was a fraud. And there was a very strong, Pakistan always had a very strong left-wing social democratic movement which stood for, at that time, good neighborly relations with India. I've been told I have to speak much louder. Is that fine?
Yes.
Yeah, all right. I was just being polite. Okay, energy. I should be my Punjabi.
Okay. So
No, I'm okay. So what happened is that I joined the student wing of the banned Communist Party, which was the National Students Federation. And the Communist Party in Pakistan was allied with the Gandhi backers of the frontier, Gandhi, who was in exile at that time in Afghanistan. And so from 65 right on till 78, when I left Pakistan, I was involved in those movements. So 68, I went to prison. When General Ayub Khan, there was an uprising against him. When he was overthrown, 1969, General Yahya Khan came. In 1970, again, I was imprisoned in Balochistan for a year, where I met the Baloch freedom fighters, some of whom are still fighting. And
what were the charges on which you were jailed?
At first, in 68, it was Martial Law Regulation 16, which means, no, Defense of Pakistan rules, which were from the Defense of India rules, which means you can be interned indefinitely.
Indefinitely,
I guess better. And in 70, it was a Martial Law Regulation for working against the interests of something like that. Mm-hmm. But when I came back after 1970, I was in university. And my parents had to do away with me because I found my library had been thrown into the water puddle. Karl Marx was not very popular in my house. He isn't popular with
most houses. Yeah.
No, no. I strongly recommend people read the Communist Manifesto. You'd be surprised. When Microsoft chief says that you need socialism to control climate change, he understands the fundamental nature of capitalism's self-destructive energy. Well, leaving that aside. Then the war happened. I joined Karachi Sun as a reporter. And these were traumatic times because the 1970 election is the only election in Pakistan where the military was incapable of rigging the election. So when people say it was the only fair election, I would suggest to you that it was such a huge country, and East Pakistan with 156 seats out of the 301 could not be manipulated. And Sheikh Mujibur Rahman won 155 of the 156. So he had the parliamentary majority. That time, we knew something was off because Sheikh Mujib told us, next time I get the visa pe aega.
Okay.
And you'd have to understand, the Agartala conspiracy cases were filed against the Bengali politicians. But the time had come to say goodbye. But the 1971 war, I was in the Karachi Sun as a reporter. It was a very traumatic time because at the time of breaking up Pakistan, the Pakistan currency got demonetized. There was no institution. Rivers were full of black money because the currency was demonetized. So there were pictures of hundreds of millions of seth ke log jitne paise the, they were just worthless. People committed suicide. So in that climate, I became a journalist. And by 1977, there was another coup.
Let's stick to the 71 war.
71 war, yes.
That to my mind is sort of pivotal in many ways for India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, and there are many narratives around it, and every side believes that they won the war and all of that. So
I don't know which side believes it. It's very simple. The East Pakistan, Pakistan was Bengal. In 1946, the only province of India that voted for the Muslim League was Bengal. Syed Sohrawardi was the Prime Minister of Bengal. None of the areas that are today Pakistan had a Muslim League government. None of the Muslim League politicians came from the area of Pakistan, whether it was. Every one of them was elected from the Hindi-speaking belt on Muslim-reserved seats. Mr. Jinnah used to get elected from Bombay. He never canvassed door-to-door ever. There was a separate seat. Nobody could run against him, so he would get elected. Similarly was the case with the former Nawabs of Awadh and UP. But all of this should be seen, 71, I have to go back to 46, because the 46 elections, Bengal was Pakistan, NWFP, which is now called Khyber, was under the Congress, Sindh was under the Congress by Allah Bakhsh Sumro, save one vote of G.M. Syed, Balochistan was an independent country, and Punjab was under the Unionist government. So Pakistan existed only in UP, CP, Bihar, Madras, Kerala, Bombay, the Muslim majority seats, and Bengal. And in Bengal, they had the Dalit party as an alliance with them. That was Pakistan. 71, Pakistan changed its name to Bangladesh. You can only understand this correctly if you understand this fact. Because Bangladesh, after the war, didn't amalgamate into West Bengal, much to my shock, much to the pedestrian nature of Indian leadership, they consolidated the two-nation theory and revamped it and said it exists. Otherwise, the slogan in Bengal, in East Pakistan, was Epar Bengal, Opar Bengal, Donar Mile, Sonar Bengal. The Indians made common friendship with Punjabi officers of the Pakistan army. There wasn't a senior Indian general who could speak Bangla. Mr. Manekshaw, Mr. General Arora, all these guys sat up with their old partners from the Burma front and enjoyed whiskey. So the Bengalis, the East Pakistanis, felt betrayed because you gave 5,000 war criminals from the Mukti Bahini to the Pakistan army and sent back 90,000 prisoners of war. There's still a resentment. And sometimes Professor Swami gets upset, but he has to understand. If the people that I had to hang, you gave away as a present to Pakistan because Benazir Bhutto is so sweet and looks good in Shimla, and Zulfikar Ali Bhutto has a cigar, and the Sindhi Hindus over here think he's a hero. East Pakistan's done.
No, I think if beauty alone could win wars, then you would have won much more.
So they won. Pakistan won because you paid for 90,000 people, fed them, and gave them back without a single trial. War crimes were committed, and India gifted 90,000 war criminals to Pakistan because Zulfikar Ali Bhutto charmed everyone with his billiard table in Shimla. Every Indian today is a fan of Jinnah. They hate Gandhi.
But why do you say that?
I mean, I have never heard an Indian ever say a nasty word about the ultimate evil in the subcontinent in 5,000 years. That's Muhammad Ali Jinnah. They think he wore very good suits. I hear nonsense about Gandhi and Nehru every street corner, every Twitter account. I say, Gandhi ne banaya Pakistan, Nehru ne banaya. Oh, jisne banaya hai, uska kyunki Nawazing hai baithta hai, uska Bombay dying hai, shayad something. To people think kya wahan job nahi milega. So nobody ever criticizes him. That's the guy who ran away with his friend's daughter. He was a pedophile who had sex with a 16-year-old as a 50-year-old man. That's what India likes.
I'm not so sure that...
How many of you hate Jinnah?
Jinnah is irrelevant in the scheme of things.
That is why you get buggered up every time by the Pakistanis.
How many times have you got buggered up? 65,
no,
72?
Every time. We can attack you in Bombay and get away, and all you want is sasta pyaz. You can't even stop us in Lok Sabha. We can shell you every day, and all you do is, we have to send you 5 young women in Aman Ki Asha, and half of India says, Arabs, Arabs! Kitni achhi urdu bolte. What is that? Yeh, India's inferiority complex of white-skinned, northern Indian, beautiful women sent there to bugger up Shashi Tharoor and the rest of India. We don't need to buy tanks. We don't need to fight. The generals only kill civilians. We need to just give you half a line in Urdu. And from the Keralite to the Bengali, I mean, who is that Miss Banerjee having Iqbal Day in West Bengal? Is there not a disgraceful thing to take place in India? You're celebrating in Bengal the memory of a man who hated Bengal, who wrote against Tagore to the King of Persia that don't celebrate him for his Nobel Prize because I am a Muslim white guy who speaks Persian and Tagore doesn't. And what did the Persian say? Allah Hindi dafa ho yahan se sala. Didn't listen to it. And today West Bengal is honoring Muhammad Iqbal. That's how screwed up India is.
All right. So let's get back to 71. Start from there.
71. I was with the Mukti Bahini. I remember the day of the surrender. Every patriotic Pakistani was laughing and only six of us were crying. We were crying because we lost our brothers in law. They were laughing because Bhuka Bengali Jaan Se Gaya. I didn't know a single one of my colleagues who had a single element of shame or character. That day I decided this is not a country, this is an acronym. This is a lie that has been nurtured in a soil of deceit, bloodshed, hatred, who named their children after the very people who raped their mothers. This is unworthy of living. I knew that because you don't go and rape 100,000 women, kill 3 million people and then come back, sala bhuka mangali bhar gaya sala. Har saal sala khana bhejna tha. Today, Bangladesh's revenge is that it is at a higher rate of growth in every social construct than India, Pakistan, Nepal, Sri Lanka. Why? It has a mature, secular leadership that said religion will have nothing to do with this. You cannot have a religious party or a religious movement and exist legally. And there's one woman who can hang the buggers, and her name is Hasina Sheikh. The only leader of a Muslim country who has the guts, the spine and the courage to say, I will deal with them. I'm not Cameron. I'm not, what's the name of that guy, Obama, who bent over 90 degrees to take the king, the bandit king of Saudi Arabia, gives an award to the son of a Kenyan immigrant, where that black man would not get a job of a clerk in that country. This is where we are. We've got Cameron, we got apologists, we got Merkel with her white guilt, destroying human civilization. And in right next to you is the greatest, grandest, bravest woman of all, Hasina Sheikh. Thank goodness for your Prime Minister that he recognized. My hat's off for Mr. Modi for being able to take that picture and give it, show it to the world. You know, you often heard the word, pardon my language, Haramzadeh. It applies to those Pakistani generals who raped them. Any soldier who has a gun and rapes is unworthy. And so you know, you've been there. They destroyed the dignity of the officer corps over there.
That I think the damage has taken a very heavy toll on the Pakistani army for a long time.
Sir, inki, as a Muslim, inki aah abhi suni nahi gayi hai. Inke din abhi aur aayenge, aap dekhiyega. You rape women who are poor and helpless? You're a man?
71, you move out of Pakistan.
No, 78.
Mm-hmm. So you continued for...
I was lucky that the war happened in a private way, that security records disappeared. So in 72,
a good guy again.
I got a job in Pakistan Television because the security agencies got dissolved and the security checks couldn't be carried out. So I sneaked in, became a television producer. I remember in my job interview, there's a wonderful guy in Pakistan called Aslam Azhar, Oxford, you know, a fantastic chap. I only discovered recently he too was a member of the Communist Party, CPGP. So he's sitting on head of a table, cross-legged, on top of a table, he's interviewing me. He says, young chap, I hear you're pro-Moscow. you know you're not going to get this job. She said, aisa hai, ki the pro-Moscow, main pro-Chinese hoon. I said, achha, maybe it's 72 war history. He said, it is very easy to be pro-Chinese. All you got to do is get the red book and bullshit and say, Pak Chini Dosti Zindaba. Ye jo pro-Moscow communist hai Pakistan, ye nahi samajh mein aate. Ye anti-Pakistan hai, pro-India, ye kya hai? So I didn't know what to say. Bolo na sach sach bolo, sach sach batao. They were laughing because there was nobody, no officer. There was no military officer inside. This is the first time in my life I said, Pakistan is free. The army has disappeared. They got me the job. I spent there about 6-7 years till Ziaul Haq came. And then I was charged with sedition because the files came up. And I was,
these are old files, or were you busy during the 70s?
No, I was busy, right? I did a lot of damage to these. The one has to be polite because it's me. I let me get this a little back.
Yes.
That might be better. So I saw in that time what they did to the Bangladeshis in the internment camps in Balochistan, how they would be spat at, and every essence of this nonsense that Muslims are one people and Muhammad Ali Jinnah is going to create a country. It was staring in your face with all its gutless corruption and the stench.
Why wasn't the rest of Pakistan seeing it? Why wasn't the rest of the world?
Because the rest of the world saw it. Ted Kennedy came. Ted Kennedy and George Harrison created Bangladesh and Indira Gandhi. I don't know why people feel Indira Gandhi and Dal Bahadur Shastri are the two prime ministers who were solid, gutless, politically active people. They didn't say anything else. Indira Gandhi went capital to capital. I recommend you guys look up what she said to the BBC and how she was attacked by Western correspondents because they were in the payroll of the Pakistan army. You see, you have to understand, Pakistan can buy the US Assistant Secretary of State, Robin Raphael, whose husband died in the air crash with General Zia. She's a very thick contract. You can, if you end up with $1 million in your bank account tomorrow and say, oops.
I don't know how it came here. I don't know how it landed up here.
I don't know. Suddenly you're working for Pakistan. Every former American ambassador to the Saudi government is working for the Saudis. So irrespective of that. In 71, all this was taking place. In 77, Ziaul Haq comes in. The one guy who has killed more Palestinians with his own bullets became the savior of Palestinians and international Islam. They butchered 3 million and they said that it was the Indians who did it. And the point is, the world listened. Why didn't the rest of Pakistan understand? That's the key question. Pakistan's existence is based on the majority population of Pakistan saying, we are not Punjabis. 65% of Pakistan, mother tongue is Punjabi. Out of 500 nationalities in the world, linguistic nationalities, they are the only people ever on human civilization who have dictated their own mother tongue as illegal. You cannot teach Punjabi in Pakistan. You cannot speak Punjabi in a Pakistani school. There is hardly a daily newspaper that is printed. Our parents used to say, Tanu school bhej rahe hain English medium, tusi ghar aake Punjabi bol gal kar deo. Tanu sharam nahi aandi.
Why was that? Why did they want to?
Because your identity now is Islam. You're naming your sons. Look at Mazhar Ali Khan, Communist Party of India, these guys who created Pakistan. By the way, other than the Muslim League, if you ever meet a member of the CPI, you're going to catch his tie, because nowadays they're mostly very rich people who are communists. Ek zamane mein everybody was poor.
Communists were rich always, they dressed.
You can't say that about Kafi Azmi. You can't say about thousands of people who lived in communes at 100 rupees a month. Today, you can't be a Marxist unless you're a millionaire. All these grey-eyed fancy aunties who suddenly are NGOs, what's a damn NGO? We didn't have NGOs. Now you're paid by a foreign government, an American, a West European, and you're paid to be communist. You're Javed Anand, or you are Arundhati Roy, or you're Teesta, or you're some nonsense, and you're giving bhashan to me about proletarian causes. You don't even know what it's to be hungry for a day. You twirl your wine glasses like this as a show of the day. ऐसे तो नहीं हम बेवकूफ हैं कैफी आजमी वाली कम्युनिस्ट नहीं बट यू गॉट टू आस्क दिस कम्युनिस्ट व्हाट इज द अधिकारी कमीशन रिपोर्ट द कैटास्ट्रोफी इन इंडिया इज एट द फीट ऑफ दीज गाइज द कम्युनिस्ट पार्टी ऑफ इंडिया सेंट 20,000 वॉलंटियर्स इन पंजाब टू वर्क फॉर द मुस्लिम लीग एंड आफ्टर पुटिंग द मुस्लिम लीग ओवर देयर वेंट बैक टू इंडिया एंड सेटल डाउन इन द कम्युनिटी सज्जाद ज़हीर का कम्युनिज्म आ गया पाकिस्तान में अब चलो हिंदुस्तान Kurutal and Haider. This cultural imperialism that destroyed Punjabi, saying Punjabi is the language of the Hindu and the Sikh. And then to find out that the Hindu Punjabi said, that's not meri zuban ki nahi hai, mari madri zuban Hindi hai. Then they created Haryana. So the British did only one thing. They destroyed Punjab. They didn't do anything else. Why? Because Punjab was the only place where the Zoroastrian, the Hindu, the Muslim, the Sikh, the Anglican, the Catholic, even the most famous Zoroastrian writer was a Lahori, Bapsi Sidwa, who lives in over there, India, what is it, India Cut or something she's written. So now you've got a situation where Hindu Punjabis say, we're not Punjabis, we are from Delhi, our family came from Pindi. Is that in Francisco? No, Punjab se the na hum. Lekin hum ghar mein Punjabi nahi bolte, hum Hindi hain. Acha, okay. You turn Punjabi into a Sikh language. Now, automatically that means Muslim, the guy who killed Tej Bahadur, that's not my language. By the way, we observed his anniversary yesterday. The people who committed that atrocity have names of streets over here. That's your India, sir. Yesterday is the birthday of Guru Nanak. He is Punjab, a Muslim and a Hindu by his side. And he says there is no Hinduism, there is no Hindu, there is no Muslim. That's Punjab. What did the British divide? Kabir's Punjab. The Bhakti movement gets destroyed. So the Pakistani Punjabi thinks he's Arab. And I keep reminding him he's an Arab slave, not an Arab. And he gets spat at by the Arab and he still serves him. To the extent now that Pakistani Punjabi members of ISIS are only allowed to clean the toilets of ISIS soldiers. And in raping women, they are said only Arabs can rape Arab women. You want to rape women, you get black women to rape. You are Hindi. And then the Indian from Bangalore also says, can I also wash those toilets, sir? You're being discriminatory because Pakistanis get toilet. He's an Arab shit. He's cleaning Arab shit. So how will the Pakistani Punjabi, whether it's Nawaz Sharif and his fake hair implants, or the general who looks like a 1970s porn star, who's never fought a war in his life, who's only killed civilians, the only person a Pakistani general can kill is an unarmed civilian. When he meets an Indian, he says, "Kaun si film chal rahi yaar us side pe?" Or when the Indians are not there, they'll creep up in Kabul. Or when they're not looking, you'll send them in civilian clothes. Or you'll kidnap a Hindu from Sindh and impregnate that girl and say she just converted to Islam. Now she cannot go back to Hinduism because Islam says we have to kill her. So to save her life, we will now keep her as a Muslim. What does India say? It doesn't allow those refugees to come here. Kis Hindustan ki baat kar rahe hain?
Nahi, abhi hum Pakistan ki kar rahe the. Achha, anyway, let's get back to that.
Ek hi hai, sir.
We'll.
Achha, chale, aage.
So no, we were going to, through your process of...
Okay, by the way, another brother who's joined the Tablighi Jamaat, a sister who's married to a fine guy from Itarsi, who went to visit relatives in Karachi in April 65, war away for 8 years, couldn't go back because the borders were shut. Behen se shaadi kar li, ghar mein aa gaya, hamara behno hi hai. Sports reporter pakda gaya ek din police se, hockey ke match mein he was doing reporting, but he writes in Devanagari. Police ne chhapa maar diya, Indian spy. Now they have no one to see what he's written. Woh kehta hai, main aapko padh ke sikha deta hoon ki kya hai, bola aap to padh ke galat batayenge na. Thane mein le jao, koi Hindi padhne wala batao, koi mil hi nahi raha. This is a joke. Ye hamari family hai. One aunt is Italian, two sisters-in-law Anglo-Indians, Biwi Shia hai, Gujarati, ye beti hai Sushi, main Sunni Punjabi hoon. So we or my family and many others are lucky that our parents were born at a time when
the world was a transition.
World, not just translation, it was in a way. Our best years for the Muslim world are 1850 to 1950, when we finally became civilized.
when Ghadar happened and Shatranj ke khiladi were wrapped up, all the churidar pajama and topi wale log suddenly realized you got to go to school. It's not a Hindu conspiracy that you're uneducated. It's a Muslim conspiracy that you're
uneducated.
And people went to Aligarh, Sir Sayyid University. He translated the Quran, freaked out everyone because it wasn't what the others had translated. Even today, Sir Sayyid's Quran is not recommended by ugly people because they are all following what Zakir Naik's lectures are. Or may I call him Nalaik, you know. These are the people who are running not just Indian Islam, but Pakistani Islam, because the Pakistani CIA does not let a single Pakistani come to this country without asking them to. So next time when Aman ki Asha auntie asks for a card, trust me, that card is going back to the ISI. But she dare not come back again unless she reports back ki ye sala wahan kya ho.
I think the ISI already has my card, so maybe.
Nahi, aapke to dost bahut hain, sir.
So tell me, you moved out of Pakistan.
78, I went to Saudi Arabia, became a copywriter.
Why Saudi Arabia?
खाना भी तो चाहिए सर, क्या आप कमाल कर
रहे हैं। No, I was wondering why Saudi Arabia.
सब कहते रॉ का एजेंट हूँ, लेकिन ईमान से कुछ नहीं मिलता।
नहीं, रॉ के एजेंट में तो वैसे भी कुछ नहीं मिलता।
नहीं, I went there because it was an act of desperation. They had outlawed 7 of us from becoming employed. One of them, by the way, Shahid Mahmood Nadeem, who does the Ashoka Theatre and has produced plays in India as well. He's Bhule Shah's amazing stage play. So we were 7-8 of us, we left the country. It was one way of exiling us. We settled in Saudi Arabia, did advertising there. I was very fortunate to be there because within a year of going there, we had the Mecca siege. It was the 30th birthday. November 20th, 1979, bum, I'm sitting in my home and we find out that the Americans had taken over Mecca. Next news is that the Pakistanis have attacked the Islamabad consulate, embassy, and killed 2 American diplomats or something like that. Turns out that it is the Saudi, the first Wahhabi, first ISIS members took over
the US consulate.
The Mecca compound with 50,000 hostages. For 10 days there was fighting. Everybody forget it's a house of peace. No, Arabs have destroyed Kaaba before, they destroyed it again. And who did they bring in? French paratroopers and Korean construction workers. They were instantly made Muslim by mass paper. Ya wallahi brother, you're Muslim, you're Muslim, you're Muslim. Korean, we sab Muslim karke andar dal diya. They were defeated. The people captured, their arms were amputated and their bodies were put in seats. Their faces were blackened and they were made to sit like this in public trials on television. So I witnessed that. I saw when 400 Iranians were butchered in Mecca by Saudi guards, slaughtered in 86, I think. The most horrendous place on earth is Saudi Arabia. You can rape your diplomats and get away, by the way. Dam mein to rokte ek ko, sir. Nahi rok sakte. Pyaaz tomato ke bhav mein chakal raha hai India. What is India rising? India shining. Our CEO is Google, our CEO is... And the CEOs are pocketing their own money. It's not that the CEO of Google says, I think I have to donate $2 billion to India. He ran away from India. Aamir Khan bhaagta to aap chikte. Sare CEO yahin se bhaage hue hai na. So, I'm sorry, I'm mixing things up, but...
You are.
Yes, anyway, yes, I am. But the essence being that...
You moved to Saudi Arabia.
Saudi Arabia, and
you were there
I spent there 10 years.
10 years.
And then I had to leave because...
And this was, as you put it, for a living. It wasn't because...
No. I was very fortunate because I saw what is the essence. I saw some amazing things about Saudis. I saw King Abdullah sitting next to a driver in a car and I'm looking at him. I said, that guy looks familiar, Nargis. They said, who is he? He's a newscaster. He's a king. You know, they're very simple people. He's driving in a cab with the driver. No, he was crown prince at that time. So it's an amazing place. They're an amazing people. But they are in a time warp. They're misogynist. They're murderous. they are rapists, they are sodomists, and they are supremacists, and they are anti-black, anti-Indian, in every respect. And they know that the one-time beggars of Bombay and Karachi can today buy Bombay and Karachi, right? So they know that. And they have inflicted on this world today ISIS, which at that time I knew was coming up, because they said every Indian, every aspect of Indian Islam is un-Islamic, is Hinduism.
Sorry, say that again.
Every aspect of Indian Islam is Hinduism, and should be rejected. So Khuda Hafiz disappeared. Aapne dekha hoga. Muslims now say Allah Hafiz, which is, by the way, grammatically incorrect, because you cannot have a H and a H next to each other. Ramzan nahi kehte, ab Ramadan kehte hain bade bhari se. So instead of shalwar kameez, now you see strange looking men in Bombay wearing bizarre clothes with no mustaches and long beards. It's as if they walked off from a set of Animal of the Planet of the Apes ke kisi episodes. You know, seriously, they're really downright ugly. And they're choosing to look ugly. And they're very arrogant about it. Okay, I am ugly, you know, you have to look at me. I never saw burqas in my life in Pakistan. The only women who wore a burqa were street walkers, or sex workers, because they had to. I never saw a burqa in my life in Pakistan. Today, in the university that I went, where I never saw a hijab, you have hundreds of thousands of women in black cloaks flaunting their burqas in arrogance.
That's their identity now.
That's their identity. You got to put up with it. They become black, part Chicano. You know, this whole notion I is bizarre because it has been tolerated. Look at your TV channels. Do you ever see a secular liberal Muslim stand up there and speak? Everyone, I've had 3-4 debates. Every time I have said that you have to denounce jihad, not terrorism, I face from Dr. Farooq Abdullah to who's that guy from the All India Muslim League Board, Muslim Law Board? He threatened me on TV. I warn you. No, Shahid Siddiqui. Kamal Farooqi, he said, I warn you. I said, ek to chillao nahi, phir batao ki kya warn kar rahe ho tum? Nobody discusses this on TV. I said, but I'm discussing it, right? So why aren't you saying jihad is unconstitutional, is against the constitution of India? If you're liberal, why aren't you saying Muslim personal law is from the cave period? We can't keep one wife, you want four. How many children do you want? Then they come and off stage, as God is my witness, they say, yeah, aap baat ki keh sakte, lekin hum nahi keh sakte. Kyun? Aap to bahir rehte, maine kiske bahir rehte? Main jis mulk mein rehta hoon, 10% Musliman. Aap jis mulk mein rehte, 13%.
18, 20, 25
pe sauda kar le. Bhai, hai to minority na? Hum mein aap mein kya farak hai? Aap darpok hain. और चोर हैं और झूठे हैं. हम गरीब हैं, सच बोलते हैं, पंजाबी हैं. आप अरब हैं, हम पंजाबी हैं. हमारे कुरुक्षेत्र हमारा है. आप पता नहीं कहां से किसी सिद्दीकी या रिजवी नकवी घोड़े पे चढ़ के आए यहां पे. हम तो नहीं आए, हम राजपूत थे, किसी ने मुसलमान कर दिया, हो गए. राजपूत है, हमेशा रहेंगे. पंजाबी है, खत्म ही बात. कल को कोई और मजहब नजर आ गया, बुद्धिस्ट हो जाएंगे. यही तो हिंदुस्तान का कमाल है ना. यू कैन बी कैथलिक, यू कैन बी एंग्लिकन, यू कैन बी बुद्धिस्ट. अशोका ने सबको बुद्धिस्ट कर दिया था.
एंड इज दैट बैड एज पर यू?
नो, जिसका जो मर्जी आए, लेकिन हिंदुस्तान से वो अपनी जड़ नहीं काट सकता. जिसने अपनी मां से जड़ काट दी, वो तो कहीं का हुआ ही नहीं. किसने रोका है किसको यहां पे? इस क्या हिंदुस्तान ने मौलाना आजाद को नहीं बनाया एजुकेशन मिनिस्टर? क्या बादशाह खान को जितनी इज्जत हिंदुस्तान ने दी, एक पांच वक्त का नमाजी, द मैन नोन एज द फ्रंटियर गांधी, हु हैज गिवन मोर डिग्निटी टू दैट मैन देन इंडियंस एंड हिंदूज? यू कैंट फॉरगेट दिस. द प्रॉफिट्स फैमिली फाउंड अ रेफ्यूज इन सिंध अंडर राजा दाहिर. a Hindu king. So we are celebrating the guy who came to kill the Prophet's family, Muhammad bin Qasim, and hate Raja Dahir, who saved the Prophet's family. So something's totally rotten in what is being taught at Deoband or Bareilly or wherever you manufacture these ugly people. Arun Churi ne inke sare wo chhap diye na fatwe. You read it, it's shocking. So I mentioned this on one of the debates. I told the Deoband guy, I said, have you read? Aap kya keh rahe? Arun Churi keh sakte? Humko nahi pata. Arey bhai, if you were honest, you would have printed your own fatwas. Arun Churi spent bloody 10 years compiling this crap, put it in a book. This is a shame on you. And you are sitting there blackmailing the majority community. 15 minute, kya? What did he say? 15 minute do. To theek kar, police hat jaye, hum theek kar denge. No. Somebody's taken the ink and put it on his face. Well, Kulkarni's face was also not bad. Because I tell you, there's something deeply suspicious about that black ink. If I put ink on your face, this is what you do. What did Kulkarni not do? He didn't do this. For 1 hour, he didn't touch his eyes. You show me one man who doesn't touch his eyes when he threw ink on his face.
Let's move ahead to after Saudi. You moved to Canada.
हाँ, ये बच्ची के साथ हमारा ये था कि in Saudi Arabia, when you're 10, you got to start wearing abaya. My wife worked in Saudi Arabia, never covered her head. This was our deal. 10 years, she used to carry pebbles in her hand. If some religious police would come, she knew what is feminist power. The Muslim man facing stoning by a woman is the ultimate humiliation.
Oh, really?
Uska to mar jata wahi. She would throw a stone at him. But she would have had to cover head to toe. And we said we will never, ever let that happen. And Pakistan was still, I had a home there, General Zia. Had he died in the crash a few months earlier, we would have never gone to Canada. We applied for immigration, got to Canada, and lived happily ever after. I've run for parliament over there. I've founded the Muslim Canadian Congress. I have eradicated Sharia law permanently as a legislation in that country.
That really? Is the Tell us about that.
Yes. Canada is the world's most civilized place.
Before you do that, can we have
Sharia?
The discussion that we had in the room where you explained to me the timeline of the Sharia law. That's very interesting.
Okay, this is. Are there koi Musliman hai ya nahi hai?
Bahut honge.
Haan na? Sharia ki history pata hai sir. Main aaj aapko batata hu. If you think I'm wrong, you correct me. This needs to be at the edge of a seat. 632, the Prophet dies. It's the month of June. It's 45 degrees is the minimum temperature in Mecca.
For 632.
632.
They measure temperature then.
No. आप अब कर देख लीजिए जाके आपको ज़्यादा तकलीफ है.
No, I'm just continue.
45 minimum है. His body is there for 18 hours. It's not buried. Where are the rest of the people? They lock Ali and a few companions in. In his home, nobody comes to bury him. They're fighting amongst themselves. Sahi hai nahi hai, sir? They fight amongst themselves as to who's going to be his successor. Because Muhammad has named no successor. Muhammad has said nothing about the Islamic State. He has said never. The Quran says, I did not send you to be the leader of your people. I sent you as a messenger of truth, period. इनकी दुकान लगी हुई थी लोगों की. They were pulling each other's beards, and that day a proclamation is made after Muhammad is dead that the Ansar, the majority of Muslims, will be the servers, and the Quraysh tribe, जो by the way सब यहाँ कसाई बन गए यहाँ के, they will be the rulers. The 2% of the Muslims of Arabia were declared as the de facto rulers So today, how many of you know that Iran's supreme leader cannot be an Iranian? He has to be an Arab. Leak kar diya paper aapne saara. Iran cannot have an Iranian as a supreme leader. He has to be Arab. He has to wear a black topi, which signifies that he's from the Quraysh. Now you imagine that the Prophet is dead. They've created a new term, Khalifatul Rasul. Okay, the representative of the Caliph. The Prophet didn't know anything about this. Abu Bakr becomes that. Look at the first law he passes. He says the children of the Prophet shall not inherit anything, but their wives will. Now, how convenient is that the Prophet's wife is this guy's daughter, and the Prophet's daughter loses everything and lives in poverty forever. So Fatima loses everything and Aisha gets everything. Right? 2 years later, within 2 years elapse, there's a rebellion that we don't recognize you. The companions of the Prophet are killed because it is called everyone who disobeys him as an apostate. Jo ye fatwa lagate na Rushdie type ka. Thousands die in 2 years. The first war of apostasy is within days of the Prophet dead. So when Amir Khan says, anybody who carries the Quran in a sword in his hand is not Muslim. Bhai Amir, meri kitab padh le bhaiya, khuda ke waste. You're a good
actor. No, let's forget. This is a serious topic.
So this is here. Next guy, Usman, Umar, he gets murdered by a Muslim, Iranian. Why? Our fine friend Umar says in Medina, only Arabs can live, Muslim or non-Muslim. These Hindi, Windi, Iranian, the Kachra party, Kale Wala, Neela Peela, outside the down limits. Apartheid is set now. The Iranian comes and kills him. Third guy, Usman, he brings in his non-Muslim relatives that were expelled from Arabia by the Prophet, puts him there, starts sitting in the mosque at the highest ladder. You might have noticed in non-Arab, non-Indian mosque, there is a huge stair. The Imam has such an inferiority complex. He climbs 70, upar baithta jaake, aur topi pehen ke. He becomes Khalifat Allah. He becomes the representative of God. He gets murdered in his home. Fourth guy, Ali. By now, the people have run away from Arabia. Now they are living in Damascus. Cool. Iranian women, Greek women, as their wives. The Umayyads all had non-Arab wives, most of them. Who gets killed over there? Ali, while praying by fellow Muslims in the mosque. Hassan gets knifed in the battle between the fifth caliph, the son of the enemy of Prophet Muhammad, Abu Sufyan's son, becomes the founder of the Umayyad dynasty. And what does he do to fight the closest companion Muhammad? He puts pages of the Quran on their spears and lances and stops the war, because he says anybody who destroys his book is fighting against God. He wins the war. And then Hussein is murdered, and then his children are murdered, all by Muslims. There's no America yet. There's no Israel. And there's no Hindutva. There's no Professor Swami. There's no BJP. There's no BJP. There's no BJP. Kuch hua hi nahi abhi. Abhi shuru ho gaya ye kaam apna karne. So anyone who thinks...
No, we're coming to the Sharia law. The timeline.
Sharia, yes. Everything is now closed now. Islam is in the hands of the people who were non-Muslim. Umayyads. These guys start writing Islamic law. And Sharia law...
If I understood you correctly, they start writing law and calling it Islamic.
Yeah. No.
Laws of convenience.
Sharia means the path.
The path.
So they start documenting how to govern, what are taxes, inheritance. Monarchy comes into Islam. There's no concept of monarchy in Islam, but the dynasty comes in. 100 years later, the laws are set. The next group comes from Iran, Khurasan, and takes the entire Umayyad dynasty in Damascus, slaughters them, and while they're bleeding to death, have a ceremonial dinner. 750, they lived happily ever after. One guy escapes from there and sets up his caliphate in Spain, Abdurrahman III. When these guys come, they change the capital, Damascus. They build a new capital in Baghdad. They then say this law is there, but how do we know it is right? So they create citations. Many of you must have done. You need to take a key. I can't say baat. So for the citation document has to predate the document you're writing. No, they backdated that the hadith starts getting written on the basis of which their previous law was there. So now these guys sit down to write the hadith, which is the sayings of Prophet Muhammad. Already 150 years have passed. For the next 100 years, they start collecting these quotations of Prophet Muhammad. They compile them, put those citations into the original document, that becomes hadith and Sharia. Finally, what happened to Prophet Muhammad? There is no biography. One guy says, yes, there is a book by, what's the name? Sirat. Siratul. Yes, Ishaq. Ibn Ishaq, sorry. Ibn Ishaq is a guy who, one guy who's Ibn Hisham says, he wrote a book on Prophet's life and I memorized it. So where is this Ibn Ishaq's book? Oh, that's gone. What do we do? Hey, Ibn Hisham, come down, start dictating. Ibn Hisham starts writing Ibn Ishaq's book. That's 1400 pages of the Prophet's life. That is undisputed and you cannot say that anything is wrong in it. Now that becomes the final document in reverse order through which Sharia is launched.
And what's the timeline between the
That's
Prophet's
about,
death?
So now we're in the 9th century. So we've gone back 250 to 300 years to figure out what happened in the beginning. It's cart before the horse in the grandest medieval monstrous manner. And most of the Muslim theologians of the time said, this is, the debate was, is the Quran inspired or is it created? So the Mutazalli, the rationalists of Islam said, it's created. They lost the war. The Asharites who said, this is the word of God, slaughtered them. And then we lived happily ever after.
So coming back to the Sharia law in Canada and how you got it.
What happened was, we discovered that the Pakistan government's Minister of Religious Affairs, who instituted Sharia law in Pakistan, and more importantly into the Pakistan banking system, which is called Sharia banking, is a complete fraud.
Why is that? Can you?
Why is that? You call. You say, how do you spell interest in Islam? S H A R I A. It's holy. It's holy. It's holy. They add another 0.25% to 1%, so the Muslim has to pay more. And they call that a fee. I say, after park ho gaya ab to. Maulvi sahab isko zara park kar diye, bachcha park ho jata. Hamare yahan jab halal gosht nahi milta tha Montreal mein, to ek sardar the, unki biwi musliman thi. Maine usse pucha kaise halal hota hai, bola kadi bakra kadi gosht halal ho sakta hai, unne ko nikah padha hai, wo gosht aanda hai, isi phuka maar dende wo theek ho janda, wo halal ho jata. Isi tarah inhone sharia banking ko halal kar diya. Aur wo loot rahe hai musalmanon ko, because we have to pay more mortgage than anybody else. So this guy ends up as an immigrant in Canada. He is now a Canadian citizen, as are about 200 Pakistani generals.
Eh?
Yeah, all ISI guys are working over there, because that's the place from where you are going to screw America. Safe haven. We got a very early indication. I was in the Premier's office. Premier Bob Ray, if you guys ever visit Canada, one of the finest intellectuals that country has produced. And he said, Mr. Fatah, these guys want Arbitration Act to include non-binding arbitration act to include application of Sharia into this. So Jews have it. I said, for heaven's sake, you have no clue what you're doing. Mm. They set up Sharia courts like they have in Britain. Divorce, inheritance, death, every aspect of life was being governed. The problem is that the moment a non-Muslim says this is wrong,
there's a problem.
He's an Islamophobe. Mm. He's a racist. He's a right-wing bigot. He's on the payroll of BJP. RSS ka sala agent hai. Israel se paise khata hai wo. We said, let's take it a step further and declare Sharia as un-Islamic. Now let's have that debate. We mathematically proved it doesn't exist. Now, therefore, it is not Islamic. And therefore, a Muslim cannot demand it to be the law. And since it is not the law, let's challenge it and we'll take it to the Supreme Court. And we came out on the streets. The Maulvis, the Hijabis and the Niqabis had not figured that out. What the hell is that? How do we deal with Muslims who are opposed to us? So unlike India, where all the secular Muslims think that drinking whiskey is to be secular, we thought that instead of wasting money on whiskey banners that said separation between state and religion is the core of nation, liberal, natural democracy, we will not allow any religion to determine laws in this country. On the anniversary of 9/11, 2005, it was a Sunday. Quietly, the Toronto Star headline says, Sharia law banned. When you enter my home, that's what you see. If I've ever done anything in my life other than having the contribution to change Aurangzeb Road's name, that's what I did. And the worst thing is that the people who opposed us were the Catholic Church, the Jewish synagogues, the Hindu temples, the Sikh Gurdwaras, because har ek ki roti ban gayi. Bole sala Musliman ka lage to hum bhi apna court kholenge. But it's banned now. Their object point was to have it in Canada. If you have it in Canada, then you can get into the United States. We nipped it in the bud, it's gone forever.
Eddie, Venkat, I need that sheet because, is it? Yeah? So you obviously are a very popular person amongst a lot of people, right? And you must be getting a lot of fan mail and checking with your daughter. What's the motivation? Where do you see this is headed? There is obviously a world out. I believe this is my personal belief that religion has often been used by people for a very, very economic and a very greedy reason. And every narrative can be twisted to suit a particular scenario. And the root cause of that scenario usually is money. Money, power, resources.
That may be the Catholic Churches. And a whole lot of Babas might be doing it. You have to understand the Muslim concept of Armageddon. What is a Muslim's role in life as determined by Sharia? Our role is seeking the end of time and working to bring it as close as possible. What is that? It is to do jisko hum kehte the daawat. Aajkal India ke Muslimaan usko kehte hain daawa.
If you put it, you put the accent.
You know, it becomes holy if you
say it from the back of the throat.
Wo kisi ne kaha ki aapke paas sheera hoga. Bola hai, lekin itna gaada nahi. To ye hisab hai. To daawa aap kehte hain Hindustani usko. It's been outlined very clearly by the Indian theological monster created in Hyderabad called Sayyid Abul Ala Maududi. It says the first step is to do dawa. So I invite you to Islam. Chances are you'll say go to hell. Then I assess who is stronger, you or me. If I'm weaker, I should stay back. If I'm stronger, then I should say that you need to do this, I should apply pressure. And if you refuse, then you are entitled, I'm entitled to extract jizya from you, which is
tax.
What tax that Akbar abolished and paid for it. If that is not agreeable, then I have to declare war on you.
So there is an element of money involved, like I said.
No, it doesn't go to anywhere. There is no money involved at all. But
if you pay the tax.
But it doesn't go to the warrior or anyone.
Mm-hmm. Where does it go? To?
Paise ka interest Musliman ka nahi hai jihad mein. He's giving his life. You have to understand that. One side is running for death. The other side is running to get American citizenship. Who's going to fight? If half the American army is illegal aliens, Chicanos and Cubans and
Mexican,
blacks and Ghanians and duniya bhar ka shekri megri log aage unne kaha tum army mein jao wapis aaoge citizenship milegi, who wants to die? I'm going there to get a green card. Samne wala aadmi marne ke liye taiyar hai, he wants to go to heaven, that's his first date. He will never be able to kiss a girl or enjoy what most 13-14 year olds deserve. To he's just sitting there, everybody else is having fun, he's stuck. His chance to get a good time in a nightclub is to go to paradise, so he's going to die. You want to watch an IPL game, this guy's in for a 5-day test. Chupke baitha hua. How can you defeat him? He doesn't want your money.
So you're talking about the dawah. So
I'm sorry?
You try to compel.
And then you declare war.
You declare war.
Now, the question of Armageddon is, the Muslim belief of death, this is not in the Quran, it's all Sharia, is that the end of times will come when there will be two Muslim armies. One will face Rome, which is Europe, and they will meet in an epic battle in the city of Dabiq. Those of you who follow ISIS know that the magazine of ISIS is Dabiq. Dabiq today is a city already in the control of
ISIS.
For them, Armageddon has begun. The war, the fight to trigger Armageddon has begun. Now, all of this to non-Muslims seems some far-fetched fantasy, like it's reality for us. You may think this is some prehistoric.
When you say us, you certainly mean some of us, not some of us.
No, all of us.
I mean, you represent everybody, right?
No, I didn't say that.
You said all of us.
All of us, I know, because that's what we are taught. I don't represent anyone other than myself.
Okay. Go ahead.
Maine kab kaha sir? Pagal ho gaya main? Why would I want to represent people who want Armageddon? This is a belief that we are taught. Roze Qayamat. Jiska Hindustan mein bana Qayamat Haseena. You see, Indian Muslim turned it around. Kya ghazab ki aurat hai? Kafir Haseena. You know, the Arabs couldn't do this because they didn't have non-Muslims to work with. The Indian Muslims had to be Nazir Akbar Abadi ke Diwali pe gaana ga rahe, you know. So now the belief of Western born third generation banking executives, day traders, mining engineers going to Syria. Why? They're going to fight the last battle. But part of that battle which Indian scholars of Islam who are non-Muslim dare not utter is that the second battle is Ghazwa Hind. Because they associate Ghazwa Hind with that Lal Topi guy who comes on PTV. Zahid Amin. So they think it's a joke. It's not a damn joke. He's the only guy telling you the truth. Everybody else is lying in that studio. Ghazwa Hind is that while the main army will fight Europe, the ragtag left behind, because Indians deserve ragtag, they will destroy India. Ghazwa Hind means the war on India. Now the debate used to be, was Muhammad bin Qasim's attack on Sindh in the year 710 constitute the Ghazwa Hind, or will it come? Indian ulama, recognizing the futility of stupidity, said, "Wo to ho gaya yaar, khatam, fail ho gaya." Jo naye Saudi paid aaye, bole fail ho hi nahi sakta tha. That means that wasn't
end of time.
Ab aayega. Because it failed, it wasn't that God has prophesied the defeat of the pagan Indians, and so it will happen. So Ghazwa Hind will happen, And this is the real frightening part of it is that it will be fought with bows and arrows. And because Muslims do not have technology and non-Muslims have it, and if we have hand to fist, then we beat them, because we are better known as, you know, meat cutters than say Hindus. They chop vegetables, we chop animals. You know, fight to the finish, who wins? This is the underlying factor that nobody wants to address. The real epic battle is between the Pakistani nuclears, which says that if you decimate this world civilization and have tactical nuclear weapons that destroy yourself, you're still left with enough millions who will do battle on horseback. And if they're not on horseback, the Prophet's armies were on foot. So we'll be on foot. If there are no weapons, we'll fight with stones. That's how cavemen fought. Alhamdulillah. You have stone, I have stone. We are more, you are less. Khatam. God is with us, God is not with you. That's not a childish belief. That's a serious belief that I can challenge any imam over here to come and admit to it that Ghazwa Hind is this. And Pakistan's nukes, the glint that Pakistanis have in their eyes with which they fool the Indians is, we relish death.
Sorry, what was that?
We relish death.
Hmm.
You relish civilization.
Hmm.
You like your own buildings and the caves of, you know, central India and all that. We'll just drop a bomb on it. It will dissipate. Both of us will have nothing and we'll win the war.
But seriously, are you saying that people in Pakistan, fathers and mothers, they are expecting that their children will grow up in caves and that's the
part? They have no problem with that.
Really?
I would like to debate with a Pakistani when the mics are off and the TV cameras are off, and then tell you what's discussed and then what's discussed when the mics are on. And they're two different things.
But that's true for most
but
countries.
We have the nukes. The Sri Lankans don't have nukes, neither do the Fijians or the Australians. Because uranium hai, wo aapko bhej dete hain, aap bomb banate hain. Aapne non-first strike kiya hua. Pakistan ne non-first strike nahi kiya. Why would a country have tactical nuclear missiles? It can only go 50 miles. If you're willing to hit your own people.
Territory. It's not people, it's territory. I mean,
but the people live there.
No, the military reason for that, and I can only tell you the military reason, not the religious reason, is that in conventional armament, we are superior by pure numbers. I'm just talking numbers. And in a scenario where our armored divisions will enter into Pakistan and start cutting salients, international understanding says that when the existence of your own country is threatened, then a nuclear device is not really that bad a thing. And so if there is a concentration of the armored divisions, the Indian armored divisions within the territory, then dropping a tactical nuclear bomb on that particular is a huge deterrent.
Of course.
That is the military understanding.
I said, but it's on your own territory.
It is on your own
territory. Neither the Soviets, nor the Americans, nor the Chinese, nor the Indians, nor the French, nor the British, nor the Israelis have pondered on that route, except for the Pakistanis. Which tells you that the people who relish life and protection of their own life do not wish to cross that line. That line, sir, has already been crossed in Pakistan. And as much as many of my friends say that there are sane people in Pakistan who will not let this happen, I've met enough insane military generals and corrupt generals who pray in the night while they are involved in corruption to say that we are dealing with a people who don't even know who they are. If they were sane, if we were dealing with Iran, sane. You're dealing with Turkey, these are sane people, even the Arabs are sane. These are people who are denying who they are. When will you meet a Chinese who says, no, I'm a Japanese? How can you go to a Frenchman and he says, no, I'm from Congo? You can't. These are Pakistani Punjabis saying they're not Punjabis. And they run the country. They're committing a genocide in Balochistan. Every day 50 people die. They've given the port of Gwalior to the Chinese People's Army with a nuclear submarine pen over there at the mouth of the Strait of Hormuz. Why? The road is going straight down 50 kilometers on both sides. They're eradicating every human settlement, 50 miles on both sides. That's like bulldozing entire villages out of the way. That's what Americans did in Vietnam and Cambodia. You know,
Soviets did it in Afghanistan.
Soviets did it in Afghanistan.
Scotland.
Yeah, but this is happening
in their own country.
In your own country, by allowing Chinese, who, by the way, have no love for Islam. So when China says Muslims will only fast for 6 hours, you choose your 6 hours. And when the mullahs said no, they conducted a dance festival and made the mullahs. You've seen that video. They said, this is what Ataturk did to the Saudis. They tortured them with music. The Saudi died. He couldn't hear music. He said, play the percussion instruments. The guy died. So we're dealing with not rational human. You see, look at the Cold War.
Some people say that this facade of, I'm just paraphrasing, a facade of irrationality that is often displayed by a section of the Pakistani high command is more to exacerbate their potential as a threat. To say, listen, it's a bit like, there is a famous paradigm where they say there are two people who are chained on the foot with each other, let's say 10-foot chain, and we are standing on the edge of a cliff. How do I threaten you? If I threaten that I'll push you, I know that I will, you know this, that I will also go down with you. So I threaten you by dancing really close to the edge as if I don't give a damn. Now I start getting worried that if this guy slips over, I will go down. Is that element, is that truth, or are we talking about maybe they have forgotten where to pretend and where to become?
I wish that were true. I really wish I was wrong and you were right. The problem is, I come from a military family. I've seen brigadiers murdered by their orderlies. I see the violence within the military. In 1971, you might be aware, the head of Pakistan's artillery command realized that many of the infantry divisions didn't have troops. They were farmers on the general's fields who were getting fake salary. Mm. So the infantry division had 3,000 soldiers. 17,000 of them were fraud. So these
paper.
Are paper soldiers. He freaked out. By the way, this is interesting. He's still alive. He's 84 years old. So the Pakistani high command freaked out that this guy is a professional soldier. He says, we don't have an infantry. No soldiers. The soldiers came. They couldn't fire guns. They were farmers. They took him and sent him. This is a side anecdote, but I tell you about Islamic solidarity. They sent him to Iran and Turkey to collect Islamic solidarity aid. He first goes to Turkey. After 2 days of speeches by Turkish general, solidarity, brotherhood, love Pakistan. There were commercial Pakistani ships abandoned by Bengali crewmen. Most of our ships were managed by East Pakistanis. So the Turkish military command donates 3 shipload, tanker load of ammunition to Pakistan. And when the inventory comes, this general, I forget his name, his book is Betrayed 1947, he says. He can't understand the inventory. It turns out that the Turks took all the garbage of the First World War ammunition dumps and put it on the ships and told them to take it to Pakistan.
That's solidarity.
That's in Iran. He got 20,000 woolen blankets that were all moth-eaten. Sher suna dete the wo do teen Farsi ke. Mujhe wo Qazi saab ka Bombay mein yaad aaya. Wo Tawaf ke paas gaye. To usne kaha ke paise to nahi hai. Bola kirat sun le mujhse. Ye hisab hai Muslimano ka. Ki you got conned by your closest allies. In a fraudulent concept of Muslim solidarity.
So, this is interesting because if it goes ahead, then one of the rationale is when you have a weak, moth-eaten army, any country, and you still want to put up the bluster of a credible deterrence, then you have to lean much more towards the nuclear deterrent.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why the irrationality factor has to be amplified.
Yes, but there is a counter to this.
Of course, I agree with you that if that irrationality factor becomes a belief and one day it just happens, then of course, that's a danger.
But again, my question again is that...
It's not irrational. Let me put it this way. Kunduz just happened, you know, the takeover of Kunduz city by Taliban. We now know that hundreds of bodies are coming to Pakistan. They were Pakistani troops. Mm. Everything is rational, sir. These are the most scheming monsters.
No, Kargil, that, we've seen in Kargil.
Seen
how,
in Kargil how also. No. They left their own soldiers behind. The only army to abandon its soldiers behind.
And not even to accept the bodies.
Not even accept the bodies. No. Now, what does India do? India doesn't even know where Balochistan exists. I'll share with you a meeting with some pretty...
No, please go ahead. It's just
pretty... the chattering class of New Delhi, or Bombay, left-wing, you know, thinkers. I found 8 of them didn't know where Balochistan existed. Yeah. One...
Well, many of them would not know where Mizoram is also. Don't worry about it.
Lekin ye suniye na. Unme se ek auntie ne kaha, no, let me tell you where is Balochistan. It was used to be under Oman. I saw my daughters do like this. Ab kya hoga, dad kya karega? They didn't know. This is the elite Republican Guard of India's left.
You're meeting the wrong people. Anyway, I'll take some questions now.
Sorry.
So, yes. I will just go clockwise so that, yeah.
Right in the back.
You got that sheet with you?
Yeah.
It's there?
Hello.
All right.
Okay. Hello. Sir, 2 quick questions.
Ji.
As you were in Balochistan, why Balochistan is taking so much time to become another Bangladesh? That is one question.
Sorry.
Why is Balochistan taking so much time to become another Bangladesh? And question number 2, as Sheikh Hasina Wajid has hanged 2 extremists who were supposed to be on a very high public eye, will India ever dare to do that? And if yes, what would be the consequences? Thank you.
Okay, first thing is why it has taken so long. It hasn't taken that long. The war in Balochistan is since 1948. Except that it's sparsely populated. The total population of Baloch under Pakistan occupation is about 7 million. There are 3 million under occupation by Iran and about 1 million under occupation by Afghanistan. Balochistan is a 5,000-year-old civilization, 1500-year-old kingdom. It is home to Hinduism's oldest deities.
Will it ever break away? Will it ever break away just like Bangladesh did?
Look, borders in this world change every 50 years, except we don't understand. If I asked you when did India's border change last, you won't even mention, you won't even recognize ke kya hua. Waise ko bata sakte India ke last border kab badla? Na, sovereign
external,
borders.
External border.
Goa ko jab aapne andar liya. Goa, when it was taken, Sikkim as well. But borders do change. Europe's borders have changed in our lifetime. Eritrea is a country. Kosovo is a country. Bosnia is a country. Slovenia is a country. These are not countries. East Timor is a country. If borders are changing every 50 years, that means 2 generations, what are going to be the borders of Pakistan in next 2 generations? A country that has changed its borders already. First of all, it has changed its name to Bangladesh. This is just what is the leftover of Pakistan. Because the majority of Pakistan decided, we are not Pakistan, we are Bangladesh. This is the 40% that was left over that even 47 never voted for. So, Kalat was an independent country 3 days before India and Pakistan were independent. So the civil war is going on, except I think that India is run essentially by bureaucrats and civil servants who their entire life, I get a feeling, goes through to where will I retire and which house. And their wives are battling each other, ki kiska ghar zyada, you know. So the country is a prisoner in India of your great.
No, so is the expectation that India should come and free Balochistan?
No. At least your...
Or the Indian bureaucrats should somehow
steer it? Indian bureaucrats should know where is
where is Balochistan? I'll tell you why. Indians have their territory occupied by Pakistan and they don't know. Gilgit-Baltistan is Indian constitution territory. Who's the Lok Sabha member from there? There are 6 seats that are remain unoccupied, vacant since 1948. There are a million people living over there under Pakistan occupation. India just says, ab kya karega?
No, it's a POK. Either you have to launch a war to recover it.
You've got to do something. Aapke Ministry of External Affairs.
Anyway, the question here was Balochistan, not Gilgit.
Yeah, so, Balochistan. Balochistan ka delay isliye hai, wo aapke concept mein, ki aap tak khabar nahi aayi hai. Balochistan will be free because the laws of physics, ethics, morality, military, culture, humanity determine that a people can never be occupied against their wishes forever. The Mughal occupation of northern India disappeared in 1857, unfortunately to be replaced by British, but then there was this tryst with destiny. Right? You're free.
But that's a 400 year timeline. So are we talking
about... No. It's a 400 year bhi ho to koi farak nahi padta. What is that whole philosophy of the Vedas? Karo, don't have expectation. Hum kar rahe hain, hum expect na de humko, hum to lage hain. Wo bichare jinki, they have just kidnapped 40 women and raped them. Pakistan army. One of the Baloch young boys, I got him out as a refugee to Canada. What did the Pakistan army do? Bulldoze the entire village? Koi to sunta hoga kahin na kahin. Don't worry about that.
Can you take a couple of minutes? I mean, I'm aware of, because, but just to explain the Baluchi problem and historically, and why is this crescendo going now? And
In 1945, just after the war ended, there was Cripps Commission, if you understand.
Guys, you want to have a conversation? Yeah.
So, the state of Kalat was like Burma or Nepal, had nothing to do with the Viceroy. Kalat had its own treaties with Whitehall. So the Khan of Kalat hired Muhammad Ali Jinnah as a lawyer to take the case of Kalat's independence after partition to the Cripps Commission to determine that it is not a princely state. Kalat was never, as the largest bigger than Hyderabad or any one of them, never sat on the princely state seats. Jinnah took his legal fees at that time was his weight in gold. He was given 160 pounds worth of gold as his fee. He goes to the Cripps Commission, presents the case, gets Kalat its freedom. On August 11, Kalat becomes the Khanate of Kalat with an elected upper house and elected lower house. The problem was that the leader of the party, the Baloch National Party, was Mir Ghausbakhsh Bazenjo, a very close friend of Jawaharlal Nehru, a football player in Aligarh. The Brits and the Americans freaked out. He was a central committee member of the CPI.
Okay, so the communist issue.
He was a communist. Almost every activist I've seen in Balochistan was not a Communist Party member, but they were secular leftists. They don't have the party structures. These guys freaked out. So the British Army commanders of Pakistan, General Gracie and partner, after the debacle in Kashmir, turned the entire army into Kalat.
Okay.
Invaded it, put a gun to his head, and made him sign the treaty accession. Pakistan cannot have it both ways. It cannot say that the Raja, Maharaja of Jammu Kashmir accession is illegal.
And ours is
right. You cannot have it both ways. But India doesn't know how to play this game. By daring Pakistan, withdraw your troops from Jammu Kashmir, Gilgit-Baltistan, and we'll then arrange for the plebiscite. And in the meantime,
let's see what's happening in Balochistan.
That too. But that's what I mean, your IAS officers in the Ministry of External Affairs are babus. You need some wicked Pakistanis to run that place, so you turn it around and say, ਹੁਣ ਗੱਲ ਕਰੋ
ਨਾ ਦੈਟ ਦੈਟ ਮਾਡਲ ਮੈ ਨਾਟ ਵਰਕ ਬਿਕੋਜ਼ ਦੇ ਆਰ ਨਾਟ ਇਵਨ ਏਬਲ ਟੂ ਰਨ ਪਾਕਿਸਤਾਨ ਪ੍ਰੋਪਰਲੀ ਸੋ ਸੋ
Back room, when we were discussing in the morning, you said that the world is close to a third world war and India is one country which can actually maybe prevent it.
Yes.
But you guys are busy talking about Aamir Khan and Bollywood.
Yes.
So will you talk about us and talk about that and tell us what exactly you meant by India can be the savior?
Look, I look at the international coverage in India from the newspapers and television channels. That's your first glance. Then you talk about friends. It seems no one in India knows that the French, the Turkish and Russians have a problem. It's a Ferdinand moment. The first time since Second World War, a NATO, a Western aircraft has shot down a Russian plane. That's not the end of it. Then it's inside Syria. Number two, they send jihadis in to kill. That's a war crime being committed in a parachuting plane. Number three, a helicopter sent there to rescue the pilots is shot down. India, in the meantime, is discussing whether Aamir Khan said what Kiran said, and did Kiran say this because Aamir Khan used it, and it's just too bizarre. Either Indians are so introverted that they don't know what's happening in this world, and they will have a prize, or they don't know that they're living in a gold mine looking for coal. India is in a unique position today for the Prime Minister to intervene and say to India, Russia and Turkey, call an immediate conference. Call the two ambassadors, says you're up to it. India can do that, right? India has no obligation. It's not an ally. It's very close to Russia. It has a,
also to Turkey.
It's called also to Turkey. It has nothing against any country. It's uniquely positioned. It doesn't. The Prime Minister goes to Singapore and is talking about little India and food and train. What? Are you crazy? Haven't you, you're the Prime Minister, don't you know what's happened? These are nuclear powers in the Balkans with almost a million people in Europe who you don't know who they are. The crime. And you are letting Turkey trigger a war between Russia and America so that ISIS can live. So India knows, has the expertise to deal with these two parties. It doesn't. India's journalists have the ability to write about it. They haven't. Now, how does Aamir Khan, or whether he wants to go away or doesn't want to go, whatever he says, of that significance, that instead of Indians...
No, aren't we just amplifying that significance? Because I really don't think it is even worth discussing. But we somehow make it the center point of even this discussion. Let's stick
I'll tell you why. It's very significant. I think Aamir Khan is the quintessential Indian. I mean, how many Indian Muslims have you seen who are comfortable marrying a Hindu and being very easy about it, who have spoken for India as Indians? I mean, I don't know about SRK, but he puts on an act, but this guy is a genuine symbol of India. So galti hogi, jaan chodo, agle goal pe karo. Ab usse ek goalkeeper se ek goal hogi, uski pitai nahi khatam hoti. And he's literally like a goalkeeper who made a mistake. Maro ja rahe hain, maro saale ko. Get him, go, baba, aage badho. Galti hogi, chup kar jao.
So, aage badhte hain. Let's move ahead.
Yeah.
Let's stop that story there.
Yeah.
And get back to, you said that the Indian Prime Minister, or rather the Indian polity should use its clout or its influence. And I think also for its own survival.
Not just that, it has a claim on the Security Council. You need to create the condition where people say, of course India should be on the Security Council. You can't say about that if India Prime Minister only talks to Indians in London, only Indians in New York, only Indians in Singapore. Itna Indian to hai har jagah. Alaska mein mil jayenge sare 12,000 cab driver to aa jayega wahan bhi. Iceland mein kidhar Indian nahi hai. So you should go and talk to the Chinese. You should go and talk to the current crisis between China and America. India should play the broker. Na bhi kar sakte hai to offer karne mein kya jata hai? Talks to karo, bolo to sahi.
I think it's also a question of low cost. And I remember many, many years ago when the first Gulf War was happening, there was this whole flurry of activities by various different political leaders to try and prevent it. And there was an R.K. Lakshman cartoon, I don't know how many of you remember that, in which there's a man who's running in and going to the US president and waving a piece of paper and saying, you know, the Indian Prime Minister has said, call it off, let's call it off now, because somehow that is. So I think it's also a question of how much can you post project? I mean, can you really look at Russia, who has been the big brother in our relationship for a very, very long time, and a man like Putin, who, and there are many nuances. I mean, it's not just Syria, it's the salient, which moves from Turkey into Syria.
Absolutely.
And it has a very ethnic, half Turkish, half. So it's a very complicated situation there. But I understand your point that India should probably start punching a little bit more above what it's punching now.
In a number of, look, it's doing amazing work with Africa. But Africa is not the one that's going to get you into the Security Council. Mm.
The pivot is Europe, let's face it. I mean, it's always been World War I, World War II. The pivot is Europe.
The point is, we are living in the midst of the plateauing of Western civilization the last 500 years. All of us are children of Western civilization. You know, we are who we are, and we are prosperous why we are, and we have less poverty today in India than ever before because of the Green Revolution, because of huge developments and by Indians to invest in their poor people and bring them up. And we've done an incredible job of pulling. I remember 60s and 70s when there was always a famine. India mein koi problem hi hota tha. Khatam ho gaya. Aiste aiste khatam ho raha hai. Log cell phone pe pura pura kya kuch nahi kar rahe hai. Cab drivers baithe hue kar rahe hote. So all is happening, but it needs to be translated into a more not as an arrogant way, but in a humble
human
Indian way to say, we are the peacemakers. We will not let you go to war. And part of it will be to tell Arabs, you can't come here and buy girls who are 15-year-olds. You catch one more time and we're going to take you down. That's the day you will say somebody stood up for India. 15 saal ki bachchiyan le ja rahe.
All right.
You spoke about Sharia scripture, but if you see other major religions like Christianity and Hinduism, even their scripture, which is actively followed, is written, you know, years and ages after the real the messenger. So in fact, most religion in the world, the actively followed scripture is written by some guy who nobody would know.
Yes.
So isn't this religion followed actively a sham, or basically a tool in the hands of the religious leaders to gain power and money?
If that was the case, I wouldn't have a problem. But the Muslim clergy says that this is the word of God. The Christian says this is the son of God. Between these two issues, rationally you can't give an explanation. So you got to keep rational thought aside. In the Hindu texts, there are so many, there are 50,000, that there is no living Hindu who has not read all of them. Between the Puranas, and you keep going back, and there's another 100 books that come out. There's no Hindu alive who says, I've read everything. Muslim advantage is ek kitab hai. So Khilji comes and says, he got 100,000 books in Nalanda University. He burns them, he says, you need one. So we got one book, and it's the word of God. Can you imagine someone saying this is not the word of God and alive? You can't. But you can tell anything about any Hindu book and still be alive. You can have PK and make it into a blockbuster in a Hindu country. This is Indian tolerance. Okay, it is self-deprecating humor. And then I will go down. Imagine if I make a move like not PK but OK and do half the damn thing in Pakistan. You'll see my body parts flying from Seychelles to the Bay of Bengal. I won't even be able to see the movie when it's completed.
You won't be able to complete the movie, perhaps.
Sir, just to sure. catch the phrase you used, and actually that was running in my mind all the while I read about you. How are you alive? You know, I mean, you visit Pakistan. How often do you?
Do you?
I don't. And even in India, you know, rationalists are getting murdered. In Bangladesh, they're getting murdered.
Look, there's one thing. If you speak the truth, you are bound to be safe, and when you die, you die with certain dignity. There is no point in attacking a religion. The point is adapting a community to modernity. I would like the district of Mewat to have 100% female literacy from 0% that it has now. If there is a Muslim who says, I want to follow the Prophet, then I will ask every 25-year-old young Muslim man in his first wedding to marry a 40-year-old twice divorced widow. Hai kisi mein mai kalal ko hai ya? No. The day you show me that, if you're talking of Sunnah, so come, will they kill me? They might. But they know that I'm telling the truth and they're lying. And that is what keeps me safe. Kare na shaadi 40 saal ki aurat se. Wo to saala 40 saal ka hota hai, kehta mujhe kanchi si ladki la ke do Pakistan se, mamma. Khud bhi nahi ishq lada sakta, maa ko bhejta apni biwi ke liye. Lanat hai aise ladke pe.
Why is there a complete silence in the Indian mainstream media about any discussion on Wahhabi Islam or what is being taught in madrasas?
They don't know about it. Arun Shuri has printed the fatwa list. It should be a hot seller, it isn't. It is the most demanded book in America. People look for it. Where is that Indian guy who wrote the fatwas? Khud khareed khareed ke main deta hoon logon ko. Second hand bookshops pe online mil jati hai. But nobody in India has that book. Every family in India who's politically active in the middle class should know that that book of fatwas tells you the whole story of the fraud that is Deoband. Mind you, it was created after the 1857 Ghadar, when Muslims couldn't enter Delhi for 20 years. The British allowed the creation of these institutes.
Sir, I am...
Ji.
Yes, go ahead.
Sir, two questions. There are two questions. One was, I am actually interested in learning about that azan, wherein they, you know, call out the kafirs to win upon them and all. And second question is that you were talking to Tahir Gora chatting at that on that day when you went back to Canada from India, that Hindus would someday read their own scriptures and Chanakya and all. क्योंकि अभी अभी पैसा आया है तो थोड़े दिन बाद तो जरूर रीड करेंगे तो हिंदूज कभी रीड करेंगे ये आपको क्या लगता है
नहीं नहीं मैं पहला सवाल आपका जवाब देता हूँ दूसरा मैं फिर समझूंगा आपसे पहला सवाल क्या था आई फॉरगॉट
अजान में काफिरों का क्या
नहीं नहीं अजान में नहीं है अजान बेसिकली इज अ कॉल टू प्रेयर और के गॉड इज ग्रेट कम टू प्रेयर एक्सेप्ट मॉर्निंग जिसमें एक लाइन है प्रेयर इज बेटर देन स्लीप व्हिच आई हैव अ डिफरेंस ओपिनियन
स्पेशली एट 5 o'clock
साढ़े चार बजे सुबह भीमताल में मुझे बहुत बुरा लगा था बट एनीवे इट्स नॉट द अजान आई थिंक यू आर कंफ्यूजिंग इट विद द फ्राइडे प्रेयर्स फ्राइडे प्रेयर्स में हिंदुस्तान के लोगों को पता नहीं है ना मेरे ख्याल मौलवियों को पता है क्योंकि अरबी तो जानता नहीं है बिफोर वी स्टार्ट द जुमा कॉन्ग्रीगेशन इट्स अ रिचुअल प्रेयर विच सेज के ओ गॉड गिव अस विक्ट्री अस मुस्लिम्स विक्ट्री ओवर द कुफार एंड आई हैव बीन कैंपेनिंग दैट शुड बी एक्सपंज्ड बिकॉज इट विल मेक नो डिफरेंस टू गॉड और टू मुस्लिम्स और एनीथिंग But it will be 2-3 steps that I have in my mind how to restore Muslim respect in non-Muslims' eyes. Is. One is for people to say, we will never ask for the defeat of
our brother
non-Muslim. We are living with these guys next to us. How can I go there and say, you know, this guy Peter next to me, can you just bump him off so I can take his promotion? Ye keh rahe na hum, yaar ye Modi nikalo zara. That's just terrible. It's so crass, it can't be religious. And there's no evidence that it is part of Islam. It's not in the Quran. This is repeated at every mosque, in every Friday, every part of the world in Arabic. And 80% of the Muslims have no idea what is Arabic. So the guy at the top gun makes you say that, attention, and he always does this with a guttural voice. Mm. Suddenly his tempo changes, become this. So this number two, I'll come to your second question. Muslims have to return Hagia Sophia back to the Church of Eastern Orthodox Christianity. They took it and turned it into a mosque in 1465, and they better not say that it is a religion of peace until and unless they return a captured church back to Christianity. Number two, the Umayyad Mosque in Damascus, which was St. John's Baptist, was taken over and converted to a mosque. That too has to be given back. If you cannot do even these two, three things, then stop bickering about Islamophobia, then live with it and people will hate you. And then aap apne bachchon ke liye itni buri climate create karenge ki gali gali mein pitega wo bachcha. Now to your second question, which I didn't understand.
Ek baar aap Tahir Gura ke saath chat kar rahe the Canada mein. To aapne bola tha ki Hindu apne texts nahi padhta hai, Chanakya aur Vedas aur wo sab, kyunki abhi abhi paisa aaya hai. मतलब ग्लोबलाइजेशन हुआ है और पैसा आया है तो जैसे ही पैसा जाएगा जैसे ही पैसा परमानेंट होगा तभी फिर पढ़ना शुरू करेगा तो वो कब आएगा कब लग रहा है आपको
मैं ये मेरे कहने का मकसद ये है कि माय ओपिनियन इज दैट हिंदूज आर नॉट फिक्सेटेड ऑन देयर रिलीजियस टेक्स्ट एज द एब्सोल्यूट एसेंशियल नेसेसिटी टू स्टार्ट देयर मॉर्निंग दे आर डीपली इनटू रिचुअल प्रेयर बट Hindus are not freaking out. Hey, you couldn't have said that. You could be varying your ritual from family to family, from city to city. So there's an essential flexibility which is there. But what I was talking to Tahir Gora was this amazing definition of Indianness by how much money you have, which means that you leave everything aside to be a CEO and take pride in the CEOs that India has, despite the fact each one of them is exploiting maybe 100 million people somewhere in China building stuff. We don't really care. We've stopped caring about the most downtrodden because we've suddenly in India started saying ki tu usi ke naseeb hai, ye usne kuch kiya hoga to इस जन्म में ठीक कर ले अगली बार फिट इम्प्रूवमेंट हो जाएगी यू गेट अपग्रेडेड और समथिंग लाइक दैट सो आपकी तो रिटर्न फ्लाइट का इंतजाम है आप कर भी लेते हमारे यहाँ वन वे टिकट होती है सर तो आप में गुंजाइश है कि चलो ठीक हो जाएगा अमेंड हो जाएगा कोई आएगा कोई साधु बोलेगा भाई ये बस करो चिक चिक मत करो कोई गुरु नानक निकल आएगा कोई बुद्धा आएगा कितने वेरिएशन निकले जैन भी हैं कब किसी ने कहा मुस्लिम क्रिश्चियन एंड जूस फाइट बिकॉज दे सो सिमिलर I said then Buddhist, Jains and Hindus क्यों नहीं fight करते?
Sikhs.
अ Sikh तो खैर फैसी fight कर लेते आपस में मियाँ भी लड़ लेते. Sikh पंजाबी है उसको जाने दे. लेकिन I've never heard of a Hindu Buddhist riot. ये जैनों को पकड़ के पिटाई कर दी. I sit and I see Hindus who don't eat sitting with Hindus who eat meat. I've never seen a Muslim who is eating pork ever have company of another Muslim around him. People walk away. The lack of tolerance that we, jo Abdurrahman, aapke A.R. Rahman ne jiski baat ki, he said, thank God there's intolerance. He meant from another way. Look at the guys who declared a fatwa on him. For what? India made him a hero after he left Hinduism and became Muslim. Nobody said ki tum gaddar hai. Ab Musliman keh rahe tu gaddar hai. Stupid. And how dumb? How? Oh. To Hindu jaise hain bhai rehne do inko.
Last two questions.
Sir, yes. I am a Punjabi.
No woman has asked a question. Ye zyadti ho rahi.
Miss Mishra.
good evening, sir. Sir, what is the meaning of, according to you, what is the meaning of being a Muslim?
Very, very, very interesting. Most Muslims will have a convulsion if they listen to my answer. A Muslim is essentially a Jew who has adapted Judaism to Arab pagan culture. Now, what does it mean? What is Arab pagan culture? Arab pagan culture is Hinduism incorporated deeply into from India into
the tribal.
I'll give you two simple examples. The Hindus do seven pheras around the lingam, and what do? We do counterclockwise. You have the male organ of creation. We do Hajj and we go and kiss the shape of a vagina, except we don't know what we are doing. So all we are doing is that the Muslims are doing ulta to what the Hindus are doing. And then why we are doing it? With the religion that we have taken from Judaism. Same monotheism, same rejection of anything, same prayers a day, same fasting, same enmity with the pig, same circumcision, the alliance of circumcision that brings interfaith people together, same head shaving, same top to bottom, same. And what does the Quran say, by the way, about the Jews? You will be given the land of Palestine. What do the Arabs say? The Jews are occupiers. Is the Quran right or the Arabs right? I say the Quran is right. The Arabs get upset. So, then it comes to who's a Muslim. A Muslim is a person who believes in essentially Tawheed, which means he associates no one with whatever the creator is, whether it's Om or whether it's Brahma, or whether whatever we call it, is one. Number two, it gets out to simplicity. He pays an annual wealth tax, which hardly any Muslim does. Ye dard hone wali baat hai. Number three, he has to pray to the Creator. It doesn't even say how many times. It doesn't even say how. Number four, if he has money,
he has to give up.
He goes to Hajj. I think that was a last minute amendment to the constitution because the Arabs said, sir, aap ja rahe hain, hamara kya banega? Sadda ki padega. Unne kaha, law inhone Hajj kara diyo. Oh, India government subsidized kar. India subsidizes Saudi Arabia. Aisi ulti ganga humne kahin nahi dekhi. Bajaye iske ki Saudi Arabia subsidize kare Indian pilgrims ko, Indian government kar rahi unko. But last, you got to go hungry for a month to understand what the poor feels. इसमें किसको एतराज है इस्लाम से और क्यों लोग मुसलमान हुए? Because you know, from Java to Romania, wherever you go, you find that the Muslim ethos was you cannot lie. The Quran says you cannot, you have to tell the truth even if it destroys you, even if it is against your mother, your family. Truth is the essential. जो इंडिया का मोटो है क्या?
सत्यमेव जयते.
वो that's Islam. ट्रेवलर्स चेक का कॉन्सेप्ट मुसलमानों का है. मुसलमान ट्रेडर साला झूठ नहीं बोल सकता था, उसकी रेपुटेशन खत्म. जैसे मारवाड़ी ट्रेडर्स का होता है आपस में, दिस इज कम फ्रॉम मुस्लिम ट्रेडर्स. इसने यहाँ IOU लिखा, वो कैश हो गया साला स्पेन में. हवाले का कॉन्सेप्ट ये ट्रस्ट पे है ना. ये सब छोड़ छाड़ के साला जिहाद पे लग गए. जिहाद का है ही नहीं. हिजाब, जिहाद, निकाब, खतना, दंगा फसा आता ही नहीं है कहीं. ऑल ऑफ दिस वॉज रिटन इन शरिया, विच आई हैव एक्सप्लेन्ड. आई कैन क्वेश्चन इज इलिजिटिमेट. सो व्हेन मेनी ऑफ माय फ्रेंड्स बिकम एक्स मुस्लिम, व्हाट डू दे कंट्रीब्यूट टू? नथिंग. उसने कहा हम मैच खेल रहे, गोल कीपर हम नहीं बनते. वो गोल हो जाता है, वो क्राउड में जाके बैठ जाते. तो दे डू नथिंग. इफ यू आर वॉन्ट टू चेंज थिंग्स, यू हैव टू बी अ मुस्लिम बिफोर यू कैन काउंटर दीज गाइज. ये हमको कहेंगे आप मुस्लिम नहीं है, तो फिर ये उसको भी कहते हैं कि वो आइसिस वाला भी मुस्लिम नहीं है. असला आइसिस वाला मुस्लिम नहीं है, को पारसी है क्या वो?
koi wo hindu hai kehte no 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 islamic state they are not muslim why is there no jew over there why is no pandit leading a charge over there I never seen a monk over there sab ke sab musalman hai aur sare india ke har aadmi that is not islam no 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 that is not proper islam but what is proper zakir naik is maulana madani is islam Owaisi brothers is islam Dara Shikoh was Islam, you cut his neck off. And you named a street after Aurangzeb. Woh was a chak ke uska muh kala kar diya humne.
Last question. So
why can't it be a woman? Kaise kahan?
Okay.
Woh nahi, there's a woman there. Ye bahut ho gaya hai.
Sir, do you see that there is a possibility of ISIS mentality to come to the subcontinent?
It is here. What is ISIS mentality? ISIS mentality is that give us 15 minutes without police and we will wipe out these bastards.
What is
ISIS mentality that says that all Hindus get out of Kashmir and nobody stands up to protect them? Is it not ethnic cleansing or genocide? You wiped out the original and aboriginal inhabitants of Kashmir and drove them out. You made them refugees in the own country. Who did it? ISIS. ISIS is in Balochistan today fighting against the Baloch nationalists. ISIS is the one who is killing these Bengali writers who, by the way, the West calls bloggers. Have you ever heard the term British bloggers? No. Gora sala writer hota hai, desi hai blogger hota हमारी कई किस्मत खराब हमारे जो काम करते वो भी नहीं हमें देते सो ISIS इज हियर इफ सम मुल्ला टेल्स यू दे आर नॉट के इंडियंस आर नॉट कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन इन टू ISIS दैट बिकॉज द अरब्स डोंट वॉन्ट द शिट कलर्ड पीपल लाइक अस इन देयर मिडस्ट दैट्स वॉट वाई वी आर नॉट देयर इट्स नॉट बिकॉज वी डोंट वॉन्ट टू बी देयर
Sir, what is your say on this whole intolerance debate and what, where do you see the roots of it?
Thoda sa political hai. Everything in India is political. You have to admit that. We should stop pretending. The intolerance is there. Nobody wants to have dinner with the chauffeur or driver with the dining table. I've never, in Pakistan, I challenge everyone. Anybody talks of Muslim Ummah, I say that tere driver ke saath khane ki tasveer to bhej. तो डिनर खा रहा है साथ दोनों चक्की लगा रहे नो उम्मा खत्म हो जाती वहीं इसकी औकात देखो तू जानते मैं कौन हूं इसकी औकात देखो ऑल ऑफ इंडिया इज इंटॉलरेंट ऑन औकात एंड यू सेइंग देयर इज नो इंटॉलरेंस हैव यू सीन टू कार्स फाइटिंग अगेंस्ट ईच अदर होय कौन आ नीचे उतर पुलिस वालों की क्या करते आई सो वन गाय कॉप कॉल का ही डिडंट मेक आई कॉन्टैक्ट विद द कॉप टक 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 नंबर मिला लेफ्ट हैंड से कहा बात करो यू नो व्हाट द कॉप डिड ही टुक द फोन थ्रू इट असाइड और चला गया नाउ द गाय सेज डू आई गो आफ्टर द फोन आफ्टर द कॉप ही वेंट एंड वेंट अवे दिस गाय इज रनिंग अराउंड हम लोग हंस हंस के मर गए मैंने कहा यार ये जय हिंद के नारे लगाए मैंने कहा लाना था तेरे पे साली औकात खत्म हो गई जानता मैं कौन
विद दैट थैंक यू वेरी मच सर This is my proud privilege to say, propose a word of thanks. I keep it very short by saying thank you. Thank you, Raghu.
Thanks a ton.
Thanks, of course, to Bharti AXA, the sponsors without whom this wouldn't have been possible. Thank you, everybody, for turning up so early and staying here for such a long time.